Happy Sabbath, everybody. Welcome to another awesome service at the Capitol Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church. On behalf of our senior pastor, Dr. Emil D. Piller, and our assistant pastor, Pastor Elijah Stanley, I'm your associate pastor, Dr. Philip M. Wesley II. Wonderful experience that we have in Jesus Christ day by day. And today is no less. So listen, tune in. Like, share, and subscribe to this video. If you're on your way, we're praying for your safety. But listen, we have a great word today, so you don't want to miss out. We're looking forward to your presence online. God bless you on your way to the kingdom.
The following is a public service.
Revelation 19, it says, after this, I heard what sounded like a vast crowd in heaven saying, hallelujah, salvation and glory and power belong to our God. If you believe that power belongs to our God, stand to your feet and clap your hands and give our awesome God a praise. Give the God of this universe a clap. Give the Lord of our salvation a shout. If God has brought you through this week, just give Him praise. If He has brought healing to you, give Him praise. If He has sustained you, give Him praise. All everybody that have breath in this place, give the Lord praise this Sabbath. For our Lord is mighty. Our Lord is great. He's worthy of our honor. He's worthy of the glory. All power unto the Lord. For He is great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Let us go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank You because You've been so good. Father, we just want to praise You because You are that awesome. And even when we have doubts, we're just asking that You increase our faith. Move through this service, Holy Spirit, and let and have your way. And we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor in Jesus' name. We pray, amen, amen. Please remain standing for our statement of identity. We, the Capitol Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church, are a grace-filled community of faith whose goal is to continually grow into the image of Christ. We are committed to being immersed in Scripture, constant in prayer, joyful in giving, and being those who are in need of a touch from God. May God bless you. Please remain standing for this moment in song.
Happy Sabbath, church. Our congregational hymn can be found in the SDA hymnal, also on our screens. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine, page 462.
This is my story. Good morning and happy Sabbath.
My name is Briella Austin Devine. This is my mom, Davina Austin.
Ready? One, two, three. We welcome our guests in attendance here, those that travel far and those that drove near. We bid you in the house of the Lord to exalt him and make a joyful noise. We may sing, shout, clap, and dance today, but most of all, allow God to have his way. We hope to please you in all that we do. In the name of Jesus, we welcome you. Happy Sabbath, and welcome to Capitol Hill.
I'm not happy.
Okay. Amen. Good morning, good morning.
Good morning.
Amen.
Good morning.
Wow.
Have a great today.
Yes, it's a beautiful Sabbath day. How about you? Amen, amen. Listen, everybody, to just begin this, we want to feature art that we had during one of our vacation Bible schools. Let's see, we have a painting by Marshall McCombs. And here it is. It's the painting entitled The Crucifixion, which he painted in 2023, art acrylic on canvas at the age of 9. And we are honored to showcase this painting right here today. So we just can we just celebrate Marshall's art. Amen. Amen. This is beautiful. And just to celebrate the crucifixion of our Lord in Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. Doc, you know, we are going through a lot of things here at Capitol Hill. We just finished communion. We were able to celebrate, go through a lot of things about what it meant for us. And we want to just encourage you as we are continuing all of the ministries here at Capitol Hill that our ministry teams know that as we are continuing to plan for the rest of the year, we have some things that we want to inform you about. And on April the 21st, we just want to encourage you, ministry leaders. Actually, the date is going to be changed.
Right.
But ministry leaders, we want to let you know that a ministry board meeting is scheduled, and you want to look at your emails and keep track of when that date is so that you can be a part of it. Doc, I know that we've talked about a lot. There are a lot of things that we're planning, a lot of things that will happen this year.
Yes.
And we want to make sure that you are a part of it and see how you can contribute and your ministries can contribute to it. So please make sure that you look at it. Doc, on May 4th, though, have guess who's coming to dinner?
Guess who's coming to dinner.
And Doc, would you mind just explaining a little bit about this event?
Well, this is sponsored by our Family Life Ministries, Jack and Cheryl Sonso. And you have the opportunity to register as a host and host your guest at your home. All right? You do all the planning, all the cooking, and everything. Amen. And one of us will be your guest. Amen. Or you can register as a guest and visit a home that is a host. So we hope that there will be a lot of hosts, and we hope that people will be a lot of guests. So we want your participation in there, and we thank our Family Life Ministries for planning this, and we're looking forward to a great time. So everybody, you want to register by the 19th. You want to register by April 19th for that, and just show Family Life your love and support. Sometimes you can be open to both guests or hosts. So
right.
We'd love for you to be a part of that. Also,
yes, sir.
Happening next week, everybody, as we had our art by one of our youth, we do have Children's Church coming up next week. Next week.
Amen.
Third Sabbath of the month, we have Children's Church here at Capitol Hill. So we thank God for our children's ministry. So children age 6 to 12, we invite you to come on downstairs. awesome planning, and we are going through fundamentals of our faith with our children as well.
Right. Doc, you know, we are excited because not only kids, but we are, we want to make sure that every single area of our church is taken care of. We want to let you know that we are excited because the CHC Women's Fellowship Weekend is coming up. And we want to let you know these dates, Friday, October the 19th through Sunday, October the 20th. And they will be meeting at the Turf Valley Resort in Ellicott City, Maryland. I want to let you know a few things that are going to be happening on this weekend, Doc Wesley. We are talking about activities that are designed to nourish your soul and mind, worship sessions, workshops, nature walks, and reflective prayer gatherings. And this is just to encourage all of the women in our church to go. Again, that is October the 18th through October the 20th. There's a $25 deposit that is due by next Friday, April the 19th, so that we can plan and we can continue to grow. Doc, I know that we talked about our kids. We talked about the different areas in our church. Doc, are there anything else that we should be praying over?
Yes, indeed. And we are praying for the Danley family as we have lost a great soldier, Brother Terrell Danley Sr. On Thursday morning passed away, and we just want to send our love and our condolences to the family. They will be celebrating this life. They will be celebrating this life at the DuPont Park Seventh-day Adventist Church here in Washington, D.C. Viewing, it will be April 21st, Sunday, April 21st. Viewing will begin at 11 a.m. To 12:30 p.m. and also the funeral will be at 12:30 p.m. So again, we are celebrating life at the DuPont Church, and we want you to come out and celebrate. So our condolences for the life of William Terrell Danley Sr. And we continue to pray. We also continue to lift up our head deacon, Robin Sampson, who funeralized his brother this week. And we just want to let him know that our prayers are with him and his family. His brother Wayne Sampson passed away, so our prayers are with. And also one of our new members, Ashton Richardson, for the loss of his father, Richard Richardson. So we'll have more memorial details coming a little bit later, but we're just surrounding all of our church family with prayers, our sympathies, our condolences, with the hope of our Lord's soon return.
Amen. Yes, sir.
Once again.
Yes, sir. Doc, you know, we're going to do this last highlight, and then we have a special segment that we want to encourage you to join us for. How many of us have started spring cleaning? I saw a few hands go up. If you have not started your spring cleaning yet, we want to encourage you to start. You know, it's an important time of the year to go through, take out some of the clutter, and make space for something new this year. So we want to encourage you, and we want to start off that process by being a service to you. We are going to be having a community shredding event on Sunday, April the 21st. So if you have any documents that you've been thinking about throwing away but you haven't gotten to it, if there are boxes and boxes of documents, I know that there is a box of document that I'm going to just come and shred. We want to be a service to you, kick off that spring cleaning. And on Sunday, April the 21st, we are asking that you bring up to 3 boxes for us to shred documents, old papers, and it's free.
Yeah.
It's free. And it's first come, first serve until it's all full, until the truck gets full.
That's right.
We want to make sure that you accept it, and we are accepting boxes until 4 p.m. or until the truck is full. And you can get more information at heretoserve@capitalsdachurch.org or on our newsletter or in our website. Doc Wesley, I know that we just covered a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff, but they're all in our text chain. They're also in our newsletter. We want to make sure that you sign up. But Doc Wesley, this is going to be an awesome year for Capitol Hill. And we're going to actually go into something right now as we continue to celebrate. So I'm going to invite the family of Sean and Stephanie just to come up here as we go into our moment of baby dedication. So family, if you could just come up here to the steps. I'm going to ask Sean and Stephanie. Sean, man, Sean, look, you look good, man. If you guys can stand right here in the center. Family, if you can surround them, go around them on the steps. Family and friends, if you please come up. We want to just make sure, church, this family and friends looks amazing, don't they? As they are surrounding and as they are covering, church family, we want to just let you know a few things about Shiloh. Shiloh is being dedicated today, and just here's some things that we want to let you know. Shiloh Craig Stewart was born on January 10th, and today, in this month, he is 3 months old. We want to just welcome the grandparents for joining us, the family and the friends. And in the notes that you shared with our church, Stephanie, under the special circumstances, you were talking about how easy it was when Shiloh came through. So we praise God for that, an amazing experience. And Shiloh looks amazing. And as we get into our dedication, let's just start with a word of prayer. God, we are asking in these next few moments, we know that you have been experiencing with us already. We're asking that you focus our hearts and our minds, God, as we dedicate not only Shiloh, God, but Sean and Stephanie and the family, God, to the continuing growth and the continuing just covering of Shiloh as we move on to the service. I'm asking all these things in your name, I pray. Amen.
Praise God for this moment. Sean, Stephanie, family, friends, those of us who have gathered in the house of God on this 13th day of April 2024. It has been a delight to be associated with you, one of the finest couples here at Capitol Hill. You've been refreshingly obedient to God, and you have put him first. And I remember several years ago when we met for the very first time together in the office next door, and you were just thinking about seriously dating. And now you're not only seriously dating, you are seriously married. And you are seriously parents at this time. When I look at you, I see the grace of God, because first of all, I see parents who have poured in to their children. I thank God today for Alvaro and Robin Stewart. Can you just lift up your hands? That's the parents of Sean. Somebody ought to say amen.
Amen. Amen.
I thank God for Frank and Russia Craig. And if you can lift up your hands, that's the parents. Now you know where Stephanie got her personality from. But you have come all the way together, New York, Chicago, all around this country, and you have said that I support as a community. I support these new, vibrant, Holy Ghost-filled parents, and it is an honor. And probably, Stephanie, knowing you, you are probably a little overwhelmed being a new parent, because most parents, Sean, are what I like to call in a survival mode. You're probably wondering when you'll get a full night of sleep. Never. Come on and say amen out there. Things have changed. But although you may be overwhelmed with the blessing of having this beautiful child named Shiloh, it's really important to take a minute to recognize the blessing that God has given for two specific reasons. First, recognizing the gift. Parents, you have been given this wonderful bundle of joy, has a sweet, cool personality. But let me just share with you, parenting really is not for the faint of heart. Parenting will push against every boundary. Sometimes, although it's great, it can be overwhelmingly frustrating, and as educators, both of you know that. Sometimes parenting will be heartbreaking. Yeah, kids are the absolute best, but raising a child literally will be the greatest test a parent will ever face. Because you're always trying to figure it out. And you already know that the world is harsh and sometimes painful. We know that more than half of kids who grow up in faith will walk away from personal faith after high school. It is a challenging and difficult time. But Deuteronomy, the sixth chapter, unpacks a holistic plan for passing authentic faith to the next generation. So I'm just going to challenge you, because the biggest thing that you're going to do and have to do is to make your faith personal. You want to widen the circle. You want to create a rhythm. Every single day, you want to kind of give them an experience, Stephanie. Give Shiloh an experience of what God really and truly is like. So every day, you have an opportunity to tuck your kids into bed. Every day you're going to see in the future, you're going to load up the family vehicle to shuttle Shiloh and the rest of your kids. Oh, somebody say, I'm a prophet. Come on and say, my friend. I know what Stephanie's saying, you're a false prophet today. Come on and say. But be faithful to the simple things that will help Shiloh choose his faith. This is not just a ceremony. It's just not an unplanned family reunion. It's just not an opportunity to present Shiloh before family and friends in the church. But a baby dedication is an opportunity for parents and family and the church together to make agreement on how they will invest in the life of this child, little Shiloh Craig. So today, parents, you have an opportunity of raising your child in a way that he can know Jesus for himself. Even with all the obstacles and challenges that face families and parents, he needs to commit his life to Jesus Christ. When I look at the family and friends, you have an opportunity to make your commitment to the child. Because everybody knows that influence consists of a multitude of voices, grandparents and aunts and uncles, siblings, friends. You will all have an opportunity to influence future relationships and decisions of little Shiloh. Because these parents need your support and encouragement. This child needs examples and instruction. So it's very important for the guests of today's dedication to clarify your own commitment, not only the parents' commitment, but your commitment as friends, as a village to this child. But let me just share, the church, it is also part of Shiloh's village. So you must dedicate that you're going to live your life as a church, as a community, as a body of Christ, that everything that you do before Shiloh will represent Jesus Christ in a real way. This commitment of a church is so important because it reminds the parents and family that the church is highly invested in a long-term relationship. But lastly, please, as I do with every wedding, every baby dedication, and even at every funeral, God gave me this point. Teach Shiloh how to count. Count his blessings instead of his crosses. Count his gains instead of his losses. Count his ups instead of his downs. Count the smiles instead of the frowns. Count the full years instead of the lean. Count the blessed times instead of the mean. Count his health instead of his wealth. But most of all, teach Shiloh. Teach him to count on God instead of himself. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Can everybody, as I pick up this child, can you just stretch forth your hand as we ask Pastor Wesley to dedicate this child? No, I got you. I got you. I had three girls, but I know how it is. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Our God, our Father, we present your child before your throne. We present Shiloh Craig Stewart before you and the angels, O God. For you have now dispersed an angel for his protection. You have dispersed an angel for his comfort. And you have given him the Spirit for his guidance. Father, we are committing him to your throne. That no matter what weapon is formed against him, we pray that it will not prosper. We pray, oh God, when the enemy sets up a flood against him, that you will raise up a standard against them, oh God. We're praying for him to be spirit-filled for the rest of his life, that even though he goes through the challenges, you will be there with him to pick him back up. We pray that you will give him wisdom and stature. We pray, O Holy Spirit, to never leave him nor forsake him. And as you see this village, God, we're praying for the Spirit of God to fall on this village. We're praying that you give them wisdom and the advice that they give him. We're praying that you would lead them as they are examples for him. We're praying, O God, that as he's using his vocals, that it will be used for your glory. To sing praises to you, yes. To preach your word, yes. To be a disciple for you, oh God. Yes. We pray, oh God, that you will just hover around him right now. Yes. And we thank you for this moment in time where we get to dedicate Shiloh Craig Stewart before you, before God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Bless us now, keep us, oh God. And let this be noted in the book of life. When we get to heaven, we'll celebrate with Shiloh as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Baby, that's all right. Yeah, you cut up on me today. All right.
church family since Shiloh's been born, even before Shiloh was born. The love and support with Shiloh has been greatly appreciated. So we love everybody. Thank you.
We just want to say thank you. I was baptized here. I got married here. I got a baby here. So you guys know we're not from here. So all of these people travel for us. I just want to say thank you to our family. We love you all. And I really just want to say thank you to our church. You all are really our village. And when I say we don't have anybody, it's not true, because we really have every single person in this church. So we love you all. And we just say thank you. Thank you.
Your most precious gift, Stephanie and Sean, on behalf of Capitol Hill leadership, officers and members, your church family and friends, we have a gift bag for Shiloh. You're so welcome. It commemorates today with a certificate, a Bible, some lesson plans for Sabbath, and a soft toy for Shiloh. We love you and God bless you.
Amen. Amen. If we're going to support this family and little Shiloh, can you put your hands together as we conclude? God bless you. We appreciate you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you so much, family.
Following is a public service announcement from the Capitol Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Hello, I'm Elder Josh Pierre.
And I'm Elder Sharon Hodges.
We serve as the head elder and the administrative head elder here at Capitol Hill SDA Church here in Northeast Washington, D.C., where kindness is intentional.
Absolutely. We prioritize the fruit of kindness so much that we want to take a moment right now to highlight just how we as a church body can make sure that every guest and congregant feels especially warm and at home while they're here at Capitol Hill Church.
So let me ask you, do you typically sit in the same area when you worship here at Capitol Hill? Please consider rotating your seating location periodically to a different location so that you can have an opportunity to meet one of our family members and guests in the sanctuary.
Absolutely, absolutely. And another thing we can do, Elder Josh, is before and after the worship service, ask the Holy Ghost to help introduce you to someone else that you don't already know, and to greet them with the love and compassion of Jesus.
And there's another idea, Elder Sharon. Do you have lots of friends and family here at the church? We're going to ask you to be intentional and greet our guests and visitors and other people that you don't know before you start greeting your circle of friends and family.
Oh, yes, that's a good one, Elder Josh. Also, on Sabbaths, when lunch is being served, we want you to be able to lead our guests to the fellowship hall for that meal. Make sure that they are accompanied even to the table that they're going to sit at for lunch.
And you know, Elder Sharon, we can also encourage our guests and visitors to sign the guest book. This allows us to stay in touch with them after their initial visit.
Absolutely, absolutely. So remember, everybody, the fruit of the Spirit is to be endowed upon all faithful believers in Christ. And we are to exercise kindness and gentleness in our interaction with all others.
Yes, we want to practice total member involvement. Our acts of kindness may very well be the impetus that allows someone to see Christ and even accept Christ into their hearts.
Absolutely, absolutely. So we want to thank you in advance for being intentionally kind.
Happy Sabbath, church. Happy Sabbath, church. I don't know about you guys. I had a rough week. I don't like to work hard, but this week I worked hard for my money. But you know what? I'm so glad to be in the house of God. And not just that, just to be here to see all these beautiful faces. Baby dedication, family, friends. It's refreshing. Yes. So, I'm gonna do something different. On this side, anybody who's brave enough to stand up and say what they're grateful for. Come on, one person. Amen. On this side, one person. Come on. Who's gonna stand up? Don't let me pick somebody. Okay. Gift of life. All right. On this side. Anyone.
I'm so grateful that mom celebrated 92
years. Ooh, 92. What a blessing. And a blessing she's still alive. Amen. On this side, come on, one person. Don't let me pick somebody. Amen. Balcony, don't get too comfortable. I'm coming to you guys. One person in the balcony, who's brave enough? I'ma call somebody. Hallelujah. Black, raised black young men. Hallelujah. Balcony, come on. One more person. Come on. I'm about to call somebody. Roxanne, come on. Give me one. Come on. Amen. And finally, my balcony people, one person. Come on. Who's up there? Hold on, I can't see. Do I see Allison? Is that you? Allison, come on, stand up. Amen. Praise team. They just beautiful. I love them. They're just beautiful. I'm grateful. Because me and Celie, we hanging tight. And if you don't know who Celie is, that's my liver. We hanging really tight. What, 4 years? Yes. And she's right here with me. So that was just to warm you up, because we're going to give God some praise. You know, when you used to be in the club, you used to be popping and locking. We're going to pop and lock in the church. All right? So come on. If you're not going to praise with your feet, praise with your hands. Let's go. Glory. what she would say? It's a wonder, it's a wonder, it's a wonder, it's a wonder. He's a wonder, he's a wonder. He's a mighty God saying, he's a wonder, he's a wonder. Woo! So excited. My heart starts pumping. My skin starts getting hot because he's so good. Remember I told you, I want to fall crazy in love with him. Every day I wake up, I said, Lord, I want to fall crazy in love with you. And that's our goal. That's your mission, to get closer and closer to God. Because in these days, the devil is trying to attack us. The devil's trying to steal our children, trying to take our marriages, trying to take our sanity. But we need to remember, no weapon formed against us shall what? Shall what? It will never prosper. against me, armed against me, shall prosper.
Shall prosper.
Listen to that. Profess that in your life. Say,
formed against me,
shall prosper.
Shall prosper.
Come on, say no weapon, no music. Defeated. Devil, you're defeated. Devil, you're defeated. Oh, no. Sing no weapons.
You will always.
always be.
Attention. And the first reality is that there is strife all over the world. Nobody is too young to be exempted from the strife going on in the world today. And nobody is too old to be exempted from the strife that is going on around the world today. There is loss. There are deaths all over us. Hearts are broken. Disappointment everywhere. Sickness everywhere. Personal failures everywhere. But there's another reality, which is that the Spirit of God is here even right now. I don't know what you are feeling, but standing there throughout the worship, I felt the Spirit of God. It was a sweet spirit here right now. And the thing about the Spirit of God is that when we come into His presence, all we need to do is to open ourselves up. And so as we get ready to pray today, both online and in the room today, I want to challenge you, I want to urge you to open up yourselves. Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Hallelujah. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, anything can happen. The truth is, anything can happen in here right now. If it's healing you're looking for, it can happen right now because the Spirit of God is here. Whatever you're looking for. So open yourself up, even as you pray. And if you're joining us online, I'm sure there will be a number on your screen that you can call for someone to pray with you right now. But church family, let's take opportunity of the Spirit's availability right now in prayer. Dear God, what a privilege we have to come before you this moment. Sinful as we are, wretched as we are, you call us sons and you call us daughters. And when the world is against us, we know that you are for us because you are king over our lives, because you are Lord over everything, because you are Jehovah Jireh, because you are Lord our healer. And if God who created the heavens is for us, indeed no weapon formed against us shall prosper. God, we thank you. God, we worship you. We glorify your name. We say blessed and hallelujah be to your name, because you are Alpha and you are Omega. You sit high and yet you look low, and you are interested in every tiny little bit of our lives. What a God you are. Mighty God you are. Jehovah Jireh. We just want to thank you. We you open up our hearts and just want to glorify your name and join the angels to sing holy, holy, holy to your name. And if you are all these to us, we know that our sins are not too big for you to forgive. And so on behalf of everybody here today, dear God, I want to acknowledge that we have sinned against you and have come short of your glory. But Lord, have mercy upon us this morning. Because if you do not forgive us, there is no place we can go for forgiveness. If you do not forgive us, there is no place we can go and get freedom. And so please forgive us of our wretchedness. Forgive us of our indiscipline. Forgive us of our selfishness. Forgive us of our unjust behaviors. Forgive us for times when we have disappointed people that we claim we love. But forgive us even when in your church we have caused people to falter. And as you forgive us, Lord Jesus, I plead that you would send your Holy Spirit into our hearts so that our hearts will be changed and we will be repented so that we can live lives that please you. Dear God, even as we ask for forgiveness of our sins, we also know that there is loss and there is sadness and there is pain even in the house today. And so we want to plead with you that please heal the sick. We want to raise before you our First Lady and all people who are not feeling well, all people who are sick in one way or the other. Lord, please heal. You created the brain. You created our mind. You created these bodies. And so we give you permission to go into our bodies right now, Lord, and heal and put in order things that have been shifted out of order. Lord, please heal your children today. And even as you heal us emotionally, as you heal us physically, I pray that you will heal us spiritually. Because for some of us, what we are struggling with, it's not physical, but it's spiritual. So Lord, please heal. And as you come around today, I'm asking that those who are feeling down, those who are sad, those who are unhappy, Lord, please wrap your arms of love around them and let them feel your presence. Lord, give joy. Please give satisfaction. Please give liberation. And let your people find satisfaction in you this morning. I just want to pray, dear God, that as your word will be coming forth today, we want to make ourselves available to you so that you will give us a word specific to our individual needs. And so I pray that Dr. Pillar's excitement to preach your word will not get in the way. But Lord, you would come forth through the word that is spoken and convict us in the way that we need you, Lord, today. And as we pray, dear God, I'm just lifting up all places in the world where there is war, where there is desolation, where there is famine, that as you heal us and as you attend to our needs today, you would go into all these places, all these parts of the world, and bring healing there today. But Lord, one thing is most important, that we seek the kingdom of heaven and all other things will be added unto us. Of what use it is if you heal us, if you provide our daily bread, if you give us liberation, if you give us joy, if you give us comfort, if you give us peace and we lose heaven. I plead with you today that, Lord, when the word comes forth, all of us will make a way or find a way to accept your call and make sure that our election in you is sure. And so even as we come to an end with a prayer today, God, we want to thank you because we believe that before we even uttered any of these words, you were already answering. And so God, together with the angels of heaven, we just want to thank you for all that you are doing. We want to thank you for all that you will be doing. We want to thank you for what you have started doing. And I'm praying that there are believers in here who will join me today to just give glory to God for everything that he has done and everything that he will be doing for us. In Jesus' name, let the church of God say, amen and amen. God bless you.
standing. Everyone standing. All my life, come on, sing it like you mean it. All my life, so with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, come on, everybody. All my life. I said, let it be a sweet, sweet sound. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. In your God is the joy and the strength of my life. He moves all. I thank you for who you are, what you have done, what you are doing, and what you will do. Would you have your way in this place? And right now, we're so thankful for you allowing us to be in your presence. So, Lord, would you take us, break us if you must, but with your word, put us back together again. I thank you and I praise you for allowing us, sinful though we may be, to be in your service just one more time. And we're grateful and we're honored to be in your presence. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus, have your way. If you love them, can you put your hands together and give God the praise? Come on, we can do better than that. Are you glad that he is? Are you glad that he gave you another chance? Is he making a way out of no way? Somebody shout out amen. Shout out hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. Give them a great big hug and say, thank you. Thank you for being my partner in ministry today. Amen. As you take your seats, God bless you. God bless you. Ah, it's always good to be in the house of God. Are you glad to be in the house of God? I tell you, y'all look mighty, mighty good today. I thank God. Even in the midst of our uncertainties, tears, we always should come on the Sabbath to give him our best praise. Amen. Our best praise. God bless you. Praise God for our guests. You could have chosen anywhere, but you chose the Capitol Hill Church, and we're honored. Thank you for all of us who are serving today. We're going to get right into the Word of God, right into the Word of God. And as I say it, I mean that God, I want you to really kind of focus in today, because I think this message will be of help as we continue to grow in the admonition of God. So, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The title of our message, Victor, can you just bring one of those waters for me? The title of our message today, thank you, my brother. Yeah, yeah. You don't want a dry sermon. Come on and say amen out there. You don't want a dry sermon. Yeah. Thank you. The title of our sermonic message today is Radical Mind Shift. Radical Mind Shift. The key to positive change. Radical Mind Shift. Have you noticed how many of us as humans, as people, even as Christians, how many of us want similar things, but we end up with so many different results? We want similar things, even though we come from different backgrounds and experiences. But by and large, I want you to listen to me, by and large, most of us, we kind of all want similar things. For example, those of us who are married, chances are pretty good that you want a marriage full of trust and intimacy. You want a strong marriage. I don't know anyone who's ever said, I want to be divorced four times by the time I'm 40. No, nobody wants that. Everybody wants a good marriage because, by and large, we want similar things. The same with health. With health, most people say, I want to feel good. Most people say, I want to look good. Most people say, I want to be healthy. They don't usually say, I want to be out of shape. No, nobody I've heard who's saying has had it their goal to be, I want to be winded every time I walk up a single flight of stairs. No, nobody as their goal says, I want to look really bad on the beach on my next cruise. Nobody has a, not anybody who's sane, nobody says that. We want similar things when it comes to our finances. Well, what do most people want? We want to be able to be a blessing to other people. We want to not have to worry so much about money. We want financial freedom. We want to feel secure. Nobody really sets as their goal to forever and ever, amen, to live from paycheck to paycheck for the rest of our lives. Nobody says, you know what my goal is? My goal is to be bankrupt in 3 years. No, nobody says that. So many of us, we want similar things, but when you look around, we end up with tremendously different results. We all, generally, we want the same things, but we need to realize, y'all, desires don't determine who you become. Disciplines determine who you become. Let me work on that. Desires, what you want, they don't determine what you do. Disciplines determine what you do. See, the changes that you need, all of them, the goals that you set, the changes that you need, I want everybody to know they are attainable and they are achievable. But only, watch this, if we let God help us to grow in our disciplines. Now let me give you a definition. You know, I also am a professor. I always have to teach. What is discipline? Let me give you a very simple definition of what discipline is. Discipline, watch this, is choosing what you want most over what you want now. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's time to wake up. He's starting to preach. Come on and say nothing. Yeah. Let me say it again, and it should be in the notes, so it should pop up on our screen. Listen, what is discipline? A very simple definition of discipline is choosing what you want most over what you want now. You got to get that. Discipline, with the help of God, is choosing what you want most over what you want now. In other words, hoping and desiring for a better life won't bring about a better life. But habits that honor God will bring a better life. Because have you ever asked yourself the question, why is it that we want perhaps to be more disciplined? We want to be more disciplined, but we end up always failing. Why is it in life that we try so hard, but we often fall so short? One of the reasons that we try so hard and we fall so short, listen, is because, here it is, willpower. Anybody ever heard of willpower? Willpower doesn't work. Willpower doesn't, I got a lot of willpower. It doesn't work. We think it does, but it doesn't. Willpower is a lot like a muscle. You know, one of these things that I'm showing you right now, muscle. See, once you work your muscles too hard, it becomes fatigued, and the muscle's power starts to wane. In other words, if you overwork your muscles, it gets tired. And you know this is because you can, and I can, have some willpower for a little while. For a little while. You can have some willpower, but it only lasts a little while. Y'all are making me work hard, so I'm going to have to give you an illustration at this point. Let's say they bring some donuts to your office. Some donuts, you know, and you're saying, hey, I'm on a fast from sweets right now. I'm on a fast, so don't, you know. But you know, you prayed and you got willpower. And so you walk by the donuts one time with great confidence, even though that donut is calling your name. It's saying, Wesley, it's saying Ishmael, it's saying Elijah. You ever had a donut call your name? Oh, come on now. No. And that thing is calling the name. It is calling it strong. But because you've come to Capitol Hill and because you're on the prayer line, you don't answer that call. That's the first time it calls your name. Because the second time you walk by that donut, you don't have so much distance, but you're looking at it a little bit closer. The third time you walk by that donut, you tell yourself, I'm just going to sniff it. The fourth time, you just think, I'm going to touch that bad boy. The fifth time, you're looking around and you say, the devil, you're alive, but you break it in half and you celebrate that you're only eating half of it. Come on and say him out there. And then you come back 30 minutes later and you eat the other half. And you tell yourself you got the victory because you waited and spread out the devouring of them. See, what happens, y'all, willpower doesn't work for long because your willpower eventually starts to wane, which is a real problem if you're a follower of Jesus Christ. Because think about it. If you're a Christian, what do we absolutely know? We know that we're supposed to do good, we're supposed to honor God, and we're not supposed to do bad. In other words, we're supposed to be good. You know, we're doing good. And we're supposed to pray, we're supposed to read the Bible, we're supposed to be nice, we're supposed to serve, we'll be generous, and we're not supposed to do bad. We don't lie, we don't cheat, we don't steal, and we don't yell at people in the store. And we're supposed to do good, and we're not supposed to do bad. And so what do we do? We try with all of our willpower. We're not going to cuss this hour. And we're going to try to be nice to our kids, but they're getting on our last nerves. And we try and we try and we try. But eventually, our sinful desires start to overwhelm our waning willpower. And eventually, if you're like me, we give in. And without even knowing it, we look back and say, yeah, I did it. I took it. I smoked it. I touched it. I ate it. I clicked on it. I bought it. I said it. Have you ever noticed? Listen to me. Before you fail, before you give in and do whatever you didn't want to do, or can't do what you want to do, before you fail, have you ever noticed that the devil, and the devil's a dirty dog. I want to kick the devil's... I'm trying not to, Lord. Come on and say amen. I want to kick... Anybody other than me want to kick the devil right... Help me, Jesus. Have you ever noticed right before you failed, the devil will whisper in your ear, hey, you know, go on, man, come, man, have fun, man. You're young. It's no big deal. Don't worry about it. Everybody else is doing it. You're not hurting nobody. Go ahead. It's not a big deal. Before you fail, have you ever noticed how the enemy tends to minimize the consequences of any kind of wrongdoing, but after you do it, that same voice, because he's the devil, the same devil that minimized it then connects your failure to your identity and tells you, you know, you ain't no good. You're a low down dog. You're a bad person. You just ratchet. And you're a spiritual failure. That's what the devil does. You will never amount to anything. You are pathetic. You are worthless. You will never change. You don't have what it takes. You can never be healthy. You can never be pure. You can never have a good marriage. You will never be financially free. Now, before you fail, that same rotten dog, he minimizes it. It's going to be cool. But listen, afterwards, he starts to try to connect your failure to your identity. Now, this is so important. Why? Because you got to know today that the key to really changing starts with our identity. Now, this is a serious topic. So the book of Romans addresses it. I began on last week, and we were in Romans 7, 11, and 8, but as I begin to read it this week, it just kind of just messed up my mind because if you, like me, has ever in your life feel like you can't figure out why you struggle, Why you can't always change and you find yourself battling doing the wrong thing when you really want to do the right thing, believe me when I tell you that the Apostle Paul, he's going to make you feel a little better about yourself. And I say this because let me give you some context about Paul. about the Apostle Paul. Now, if you don't know, the Apostle Paul was a brother that experienced and encountered the risen Jesus Christ. He experienced Jesus. In other words, he had an encounter with Jesus. Literally, he experienced him. Here's a guy that God used to raise the dead. The Apostle Paul, I'm trying to give you a little background on the Apostle Paul. He wrote almost one third of the New Testament, and as close to God as he was, and as impactful as his ministry had become, I want to show you the words that he said in Romans chapter 7, verses 15, 19, and 20. He says this in essence. Because I had to read it again, because when I read that Paul said it, it made me feel a little better about myself. In other words, he is saying, hey, I don't really understand myself. Do any of you ever feel like Paul sometimes? He says, I want to do right, but I can't. I want to do what's good, but I don't. I don't want to do what's wrong, but I do it anyway. In other words, he almost sounds crazy in a way that's very endearing. And then he says, watch this. His concluding word was, oh, what miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Now he was so bent on getting deliverance because he couldn't understand. He said, the good that I would, I do not. That which I don't want to do, I find myself doing. I'm so much this, but I want to be that. Who can help me change? Who can help me be better? Who can help me do what I want? Who can help me stop doing what I don't want to do? Now he had those questions, but for right now, we're going to put a pin on Paul's answer. But I want you to watch whenever the Apostle Paul was struggling the most. You will see that the root of his problem in this particular dilemma is how he defines his identity. Because we're going back to verse 24, and he says this about himself. He says, oh, what miserable person I am. He's talking about himself. He says, I'm messed up. I'm jacked up. Oh, what a, listen, he says, what a wretched man I am. In one version, he said, because I'm bad, because I'm pathetic, I can't do what I want. And I'm always ending up doing the wrong thing. So he enters in what I would like to call this afternoon a cycle of shame. Let me show it to you. And I'm going to show it to you by asking you a question. Why is it that we have such a difficult time changing? Why is it that by nature, you know, we are convinced that we're bad? And because we think we are bad, look what that thought does to our behavior. What are we going to do? Because we are works oriented, when we begin to think that we are no good, we begin to think that we are pathetic. When we begin to have the Paul syndrome, when he began to identify himself, oh, wretched man that I am. What we're going to do now, we're going to try. And we're going to try really hard. I'm going to try. Whatever it is, I'm going to try. I'm going to try to wake up early. I'm not going to hit the snooze button four times. I'm going to go to the gym. I'm going to do 10 sit-ups a day. I'm going to stop eating carbs. I'm going to stop spending more than I make. I'm going to stop being a rude person. I'm going to start being well. I'm going to try to be more generous. And then once we try for a little while, we may have a few days, a few weeks maybe of success. But the truth of the matter is, eventually our willpower begins to wane. And our strength, we just don't have enough of strength to get it done, but we're trying. And once our willpower wanes, we have some sort of inevitable failure. And so we sin, we lose control of our temper, we say the wrong things, we fall into a lustful moment. And after the inevitable failure, what do we experience? We experience tremendous guilt and shame, which reinforces the belief, I'm never going to be able to really please God. I'm always going to be bad. So what do? Then we try hard again to be something that we're not. But deep down, our distorted reality and identity discourages us and disrupts our ability to become who God has called us and created us to become. It's called a cycle of shame. And one day we wake up and think, I just can't do this mess no more. I'm over this religious thing. I'm just going to throw in the towel and do my own thing. I can never really be different on the inside. Something's wrong. Something's not working. Something is not right in my life. But what I want to tell you is not something that you're missing. It's someone. And that someone you're missing comes with a power that you do not have. Because the Apostle Paul was wrestling through his distorted identity. And when he comes upon the truth and preaches to himself, hey, God, who is it that's going to free me from this life that is dominated by sin? Who can help me to change? Who can help me actually be different? Who can help me really honor God? And he answers the question. He says, thank God. The answer is Jesus Christ, our Lord. It's in Jesus Christ. It is a power that I do not have because he who the Son sets free. I wish I had a witness here today. It's free in day. And this is the key. Listen, listen, listen. It starts with identity. It's not all about behavior. And the root is this. It's not about behavior modification. We're talking about a spiritual transformation. And believe me, there is a night and day difference between behavior modification and spiritual transformation. It's not about you trying to be a better version of you. It's about a power greater than what you have that changes you from the inside out and empowers you to become the person that God wants you to be. It starts with identity. As a matter of fact, somebody say that right now. Say, it starts with identity. Say it right now. It starts with identity. Say it again. It starts with, one more time. It starts with what? Identity. Matter of fact, somebody online in the virtual space needs to put that in the chat. It starts with identity. And I say that very seriously because the devil wants you to think that you are what you did. You're not bad because you failed. And you are not what you did. And you are not who others say you are. And you're not even what that own voice, that internal voice of discouragement that condemns you in your mind says you are. Who are you? You are who God says you are. And if you're in Christ, you're forgiven. If you're in Christ, he says you're free. If you're in Christ, he says there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He says you are an ambassador of the Most High God. He says you are called and set apart. He says you have the righteousness of God in Christ dwelling within you. He says you can do all things, anything he called you to do through the power of Christ that gives you strength. He says you are an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of your testimony. See, when you know who you are, it's not about behavior modification. It's about spiritual transformation. And it begins with how you see the core of your identity. Because now I'm a child of God. See, you got to be clear, because you got to know you're not just a better version of you. You're different. No, you're new. The Bible says the old self, that pathetic self, is gone. And behold, because of Jesus, everything has become new. It's about a transformation that he works out in your insides. So listen, somebody needs to hear this. Somebody came down here in the house of God, and you're still kind of wondering if you're really and truly a Christian, a child of God. If you have surrendered your life and declared him as Lord of your life, you belong to Jesus. Somebody ought to say amen out there. You've been adopted into the family of God. You are a joint heir with Christ. You belong to Jesus. So would you just help your own self out today? Would you just say that to yourself? Because I'm looking at some of your faces, and although you're here this Sabbath, maybe you've flown here, maybe you have driven here, maybe you have just showed up here, you need to understand who you are in Christ Jesus. And so you need to do some self-talk today and say, I belong to Jesus. Type it in the chat. Come on, everybody, say, I belong to Jesus. Come on, say it kind of, say it like you mean it. I belong, come on, say it. I belong. Belong to Jesus. Come on, one more time. I belong to Jesus. Say it like you believe it. I belong to who? He is my source. I belong to Jesus. He is my identity. I belong to Jesus. He is my strength. I belong to Jesus. His power is made perfect in my weakness. And when this becomes your true identity and you begin to believe it, it changes everything. When you recognize you belong to Jesus, listen, you're no longer a slave to your sinful desires, but you are now filled with the Spirit of God that gives you strength. On Wednesday night, we talked about the Holy Spirit. You need to go back and watch that for our Wednesdays in the Word, because it's the Spirit that gives you strength to choose what you want most over what you want now. It's the Spirit that gives us strength to choose what you want most over what you want now. How, Doc Peeler, how do we do this, what you're talking about? How can we practically walk this out? How do we live this out, what you're talking about? I'm talking about, now I know everybody here is looking good, smelling good on Sabbath morning. We've had a good worship and praise, and we've prayed, and we've seen a great baby dedication. You're talking about you belong to Jesus, and Jesus is on the inside. How do we live this out practically? I'm talking about like on Tuesday morning, and you feel like cussing somebody out. How do we live this out? Galatians 5:16 says this. The Apostle Paul says this, that same apostle. He said, I say, walk by the Spirit. Let that soak in. Walk by the Spirit. The Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Walk by the Spirit. How do I practically live this out? You live this out by walking in the Spirit. Walk by the Spirit. Now, here's what you're going to do. If you really want change, you're going to walk in the Spirit. And when you do, When you walk in or by the Spirit, he gives us the last part of that verse. If you walk in the Spirit, you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Now, what does that mean? That's kind of God talk. Gratify the flesh, the desires of the flesh. are you talking about my skin? I like putting on Neutrogena. I like, no. I don't like to be ashy. No, it's not talking about your skin. It's the Greek word sarx, S-A-R-X, in the transliterated form. And that word sarx, flesh, is used over 147 times in the New Testament. And what this word means, listen, what it means is your sinful nature. We are born in sin and shapen in iniquity. It's your sinful desires. The Apostle Paul said it elsewhere. He said, we no longer put confidence in the flesh. In other words, we put no confidence, here it is, in our willpower. But we're going to walk in the Spirit. So when you're walking in the Spirit, when we're faithful to the direction of God, when we're empowered by the Spirit, listen, the Bible says we will not gratify the desires of our sinful fleshly nature. Now the word walk in the Greek is from the Greek word peripateo. And it is in the present tense verb form. And I like this. What it means is when it's the present tense verb, it means walking in the Spirit. It means that it is a continuous regular action. It's a habitual way of life. When you walk by the Spirit, it's not a one-time event, come into the church, get all hyped up, and give your life. No. It's an ongoing, habitual way of life. What are you doing? I'm waking up and I'm depending on the Spirit. What are you doing? Well, I'm asking the Spirit to give me the words to say. What are you doing? Every morning I'm asking the Spirit to give me the wisdom to know what to do. What am I doing? I'm asking the Spirit to give me the power to say yes to what's right instead of what's wrong. What are you doing? Every morning I get up, I'm asking the Spirit to give me power to say no. And I recognize, because I'm walking in the Spirit, it's not my power. It's not my willpower. It's the power of the Spirit of God in me. And I'm walking in the Spirit. I'm walking in the Spirit. So God, oh, this made me shout. So God is literally calling each of us to take a step of faith. But because it's in the continual present tense, God is saying, don't just take one step. Decide to take a step of faith, and then right behind that, you decide to take another step of faith, followed by another step of faith, followed by a continuous, habitual action of depending on God, another step of faith, and then another step of faith. And before long, once you're taking enough steps of faith, you're not living according to sight, but you're walking according to the Spirit. And I know it sounds almost crazy and undoable in the beginning, until your identity is formed. And it's formed by moment declaring, I belong to Jesus. It begins with the radical mind shift and not accepting what the devil tells you you are. You stand up with your head up, but with your faith bowed, and say, I belong to Jesus. You got to change your mind. So now, because I have a shift in my mind of who I am, who my identity is, I don't just show up at church out of habit, but now I know I need his presence with me every day. So God, please, every day, every hour, please guide my steps. God, please direct my thoughts. God, please renew my mind. Please empower my words. God, please use my life. And moment by moment, by moment, by moment, it becomes literally a succession of steps when you're walking in the Spirit of God. And when you're walking in the Spirit of God, guess what? You don't obey the desires of the flesh. It literally becomes a spiritual habit that's born out of spiritual identity, because every day I'm walking in the Spirit of God. Now, what's interesting to me is the metaphor that Paul uses. He says, you're walking in the Spirit. He did not say you're running in the Spirit. In other words, it takes some time to get there. See, the challenge with what you want now, the sinful desires, what you want now, I gotta have it now. You're 2 days from graduating from college and you wanna sit in the C-suite running your own company. The challenge of that I want it now, the challenge with what you want it now is that it almost always has an immediate payoff. That donut tastes good now. Sending that mean, that evil text because somebody hurt your feelings, that hateful text when you're mad, it feels good now. Sexual sin feels good now. Yeah, because the Bible says the pleasures of sin are good for a season. Y'all quiet on me now. Acting too holy for me now. Listen. The desires of the flesh have an immediate payoff, but the greater reward, the greater reward, it almost always takes more time, because discipline is choosing what you want most over what you want now. So ask yourself, what do you want most? What do you want most? Do you want a godly marriage? Do you want a rich spiritual legacy? Do you want financial freedom? Do you want a meaningful ministry? Do you want a useful life? But you got to recognize the greater reward almost always takes time. It's walking by the Spirit. It's depending on God day by day, moment by moment. That is what leads to a greater reward. So when your identity shifts, when you begin to recognize who you are and that you belong to God, it begins to break the cycle. It breaks the cycle. And instead of trying hard and the willpower wanes and you fail, and after you fall, you feel horrible, and then the cycle goes on and on and on and on to the break of dawn. That's another sermon I'm trying to say. And it looks more now like this. I belong to Jesus, and because I belong to Jesus, I'm going to walk in the Spirit. So that means I'm going to depend on Him. So when I'm weak, as I'm walking in the Spirit, And we're all going to be weak on times and days and moments. When I'm weak, watch this. His Spirit will help you. Now, I know everybody talks about, this is not just God talk. I'm talking about spiritual transformation, how it works. I depend on the Spirit, and then what happens is it begins to build up my faith. Because I'm not doing this thing by myself, but I know that God is with me and the Spirit is inside of me. And now I am walking in the Spirit, and daily I'm depending on the Spirit, and it begins to build my faith. And then after it builds my faith, then what does it do? It begins to empower my right actions, which then in turn does what? Then in turns, it makes me closer to God, and it reinforces the root identity that I am His and He is mine. I belong to Jesus. His power is within me. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead, it dwells in me. My brothers and my sisters, I got good news. We all can change when our identity changes. It's not behavior modification, it's genuine spiritual transformation, and it's empowered by the risen Son of God. And then, suddenly, miraculously, you're not shame-driven, you're not trying to try harder, but instead, you're spirit-led, you're not trying to control your flesh, which you cannot do, but you're depending now on the Spirit of God, and because we belong to Jesus, He is now empowering us to become more and more like Him, and the good news is, the good news is, we're no longer striving and living for the future results. The future results that are way in the future, way out there. Like when I finally get married one day. Or when my kids are finally behaving one day. You know, in other words, you're not trying to look for the future results in the future. I belong to Jesus, and because I belong to Jesus, I can experience God's victory now. You're not looking to the future anymore. Or when we finally lose that extra 25 pounds one day. When I finally get my cholesterol down one day, when I finally pay off my student loan one day, come on, Joe Biden, one day, we're not living for the results in the future. We're living from an identity today. Somebody shout out today. Today. Because our identity, our correct identity, drives actions, and actions create results. And so when you are walking in the Spirit, you wake up one day and you say, I belong to you, Jesus. And because I belong to you, Jesus, there's a transformation because there has been a radical mind shift. And I'm not trying to read my Bible. And I'm not trying to pray so much. And I'm not trying to be a better person. No, because I belong to Jesus, I want to read the Bible. Because I belong to Jesus, I like spending time in His presence. Hey, because I belong to Jesus, I want to honor God with my body. So I'm not trying to get up and go to the gym. I'm not trying because I'm doing this because I believe that my body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. I choose now to be empowered by the Spirit. And for those who might be struggling with lust, when you have this radical mind shift, but you change your identity, and that you are a godly person, and suddenly you realize, because now the mind is shifting and it's becoming the mind of the master, becomes the master of your mind. You recognize because you're struggling with that thing. And one day you say, I don't need porn no more. That's stupid. It's fake. It's disgusting. And now you can stand in the authority of Christ to whom you belong. You can say, when I feel tempted, I'm empowered to make the right decision. And then I love the freedom of not worrying about being caught. And I love the joy of not feeling the guilt. And I love the intimacy that I now have in my marriage that's real and not a mirage. Because as I get to know Him, it literally reinforces my identity, and I'm becoming more and more and more and more like Him. It's who I am in Christ. And I'm different with God's help. I'm different by His Spirit. I'm different. I'm changed by His power. Because He's helped me choose what I want most over what I want now. It's the joy of discipline. And some of you saying, yeah, Pat, you're the pastor. I'm so glad it's easy for you. Yeah, you're talking junk now. You're ordained. You glow in the dark. You got spiritual power, all that kind of stuff. Let me keep it real. There are times post-conversion, post-ministry, I struggle. I'm talking about after I'm in Christ, but after I gave my heart, I I've done it, I still couldn't get it right. Why? Because deep down inside, I believed the devil's lie. I felt I'm still unworthy. I'm still no good. I'm still a fraud. I'm still internally messed up. And you conclude, I'm probably ain't gonna make it. And I tried hard to do what's right. I tried really hard to do, not to do what's wrong. But the good news is somewhere in the middle of it, the Spirit convicts me to get rid of that stinking thinking. And He reminds me that I am bought with a price and I can do all things through Christ that strengthened me. See, we have to wake up every day with a true identity in who that God says you are. You're new in Christ. You're forgiven. You're changed. You are an overcomer. So let's declare by faith, I'm changing my identity. And I want you to get this. And here's the little secret. I believe it's a life-changing secret. Then I need discipline. Is that what you're telling me, Pastor? I need self-control. Well, you want that? Yeah, all of us need more of it. When I listen to people, when I listen to my own self, we all want discipline. We all want self-control. And all of us are growing. All of us are getting better. But it hit me. Do you know what self-control, discipline is? It's a fruit of the Spirit. It's not a fruit of your willpower. Galatians 5 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, and what else? Say it loud. It says, and self-control. It's a fruit of the Spirit. So what do? It begins by answering the question, what do you really want most? I'm talking to you today. Don't play around today. What do you want to be different? Internally, you don't have to shout it out. I just want everybody just to really listen to what the Spirit is saying, because we have so many secret agents instead of uniformed soldiers. We have people who love talking about Christ, but they have no power in Christ. But God has brought us here in this moment, on this day, and He's challenging all of us. And you need to start by asking the question, what do you want in your life to be different? Name it, whatever it is, what do you want most? Not just what do you want most. Let me just take it a bit further. Who do you really want to become? Whatever it is, moment by moment, it begins, the change begins when we learn how to walk in the Spirit. Oh, yeah, you might mess up. Confess it. God, I ask for your forgiveness, but give me strength for the day. And I'm going to declare that I'm going to continue the successions of steps, learning to depend on God until it becomes habitual or a habit, step by step. I'm walking according to the Spirit, and I'm not gratifying the desires of the flesh. In other words, God's Spirit in you, God's Spirit in you, God's Spirit in you helps you choose what you want most over what you want now. And that's how you change. That's how I change. It's not by willpower, but by the power of the Spirit that dwells in us. And Father, we stand today recognizing who we are in you. And because, God, we belong to you, my prayer for Capitol Hill and its friends today, I pray that you would help us depend on your Spirit moment by moment. We won't always get it right, but when we fail, we don't run from you. We are determined to run to you. I want you to teach us to walk by faith, moment by moment, depending on you, so we will not gratify the desires of our sinful flesh, because the devil says you're done, but God says you're mine. It's not over for you. You're not dead. And no weapon formed against us. We walk in the Spirit, not by sight. We begin to renounce the flesh. And then, watch this, the dead comes to life because, listen, everybody shout out with me. Say, no weapon. No weapon formed against us. And he came 17 years old. Pastoring in California, and God allowed me to enter the lives of young men. And he came, said, "This is all right." Now, Lawrence was one of my members, and Lawrence was part of the Job Corps. And he was on fire at the time in his life, and he literally would invite other Job Corps, people in the Job Corps, to church. He was fired up, and I'll never forget. They brought this gentleman, and he wanted to meet him, to meet me in the office. And so after service, he comes to me and he said, Pastor, I want you to meet my friend. And you got to understand, his friend was a handsome brother, 17 years old. He was just that good, dark skin, didn't have a flaw on his skin. He was quite built. And he introduced me. I said, "How you doing?" When, you know, we did the dap thing and so forth like that. And I said, "What's your story, man?" I said, "Glad you're here." I said, "What's your story?" He said, "My story?" He goes, "You know, he says, I'm good." I said, "What do you mean you're good?" Looked him straight in his eyes. I said, "What do you mean you're good? What's that mean?" Said, "You know what I'm saying?" "Didn't I just ask you a question?" You know what I'm saying? "No, I don't know what you're saying. Say what you want to say, boy." And so he started telling me his life. He was a third generation gangbanger. His dad, grandfather, was a part of the original Crips, the Hoover Crips in L.A. And I learned that his grandfather, listen, died at 20 by. And I learned that his father died at 21 by violent death. And just as calm as I'm talking right now, his name was Keith. Keith said, Reverend, he says, you know, I ain't been to church for a while, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, I'm glad I came, you know, because, you know, I'm getting ready to die. I said, why you say that? He said, you know, he goes, granddaddy, my daddy. He goes, I'm 17. He goes, man, I'm going to meet my end. He goes, man, I did some, you know, messed up. I'm going to give you the sanitized version. He said, I've done some stuff that it's going to catch up to me. I'm only in the Job Corps because, you know, I'm just kind of running, you know, 60 miles away from Inland Empire and L.A., and so I'm just kind of laying low, but they're going to catch me, and they're going to do me. And all of what he was saying was actually true. And he had, you know, all the chains. He had black. He had the regalia. He had cornrows. And I'll never forget, Keith. He was telling me. He says, I'm glad I came to church today. I said, you like church? He said, it was all right. He says, all right. He said, you seem cool. He said, but you know what? Well, I'm glad. He said, you know what I'm saying? He goes, you know, I'm glad. True story. He said, you know what I'm saying? He said, now I'm going to have my own reverend to do my funeral. Will you do my funeral? I said, no. Ain't that what you guys do? You marry people, you bury people. Don't you do that? Ain't that part of your job description? Don't reverends do that? I said, yeah, but you ain't going to die. He said, I just told you they're after me. They got me. He said, but I said, you're not going to die. I said, no. I said, listen, you're going to die if you think that you're going to die. You came today not to die. You came today because the Lord wants you to live. Literally. He looks at me. He says, well, you know, yeah. He kind of dismissed it. He says, if you do my funeral, and he kept on, and he says, I want you to open up my casket right when you're going to lower it down. He was literally stuck on dying because he believed the identity of a gangbanger, and gangbangers in those days, in those tough times in Southern California, in which I was a part of some of those truces. He believed that death was his identity. And he told me, he said, I want you to make sure, Rev, that, you know, you take, you know, they had malt liquor, they had Schlitzbach liquor. He goes, make sure you get, you know, the blue rags, you know, represent the Crips, and make sure all my homies drop them, and then have them pour, you know, the malt liquor into the casket, and make sure they lower it down, and make sure you playing some rap music. I said, no, man. I said, God did not. I ain't doing all that because you ain't dying. He looks at me, he says, what you talking about? I said again, God brought you here. He created you so that you could have life. You got to change your mind. And when you change your mind and you stand on the promises of God, that you are the head and not the tail, that you are above and not beneath, that you have a future and not just the past, that God wants to raise you up in the power of his creation for your life. And I said, man, I'll see you next week. And he says, yeah. I said, will you be here? He and Lawrence walks out the door. The next week, I want you to know. He began to think about what I said, and so he came the next week. And 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 on that fourth week, I made a call at the end of my a message for the day. And he was cool sitting in the back, but when the Spirit of God begins to hit you and begins to regenerate you and begin to pour life back into you and begin to change your mind, from the back of the auditorium, he came and he broke down, and all he said in my arms, I want to live. I want to live. I want to live. Began to work with him, and he was baptized. And not only did he live, but he began to thrive. He began to work in our young people's department. I mean, he was a student, but he began to hold everybody else accountable. And my own young people started straightening up because when they come in, hey, you late. What's up with that, man? Y'all. We began to have a dialogue. We began to build a friendship. And it was a gracious church like our church is. There might be a few people who say, well, you know, do we really want to be in all of this? Because, you know, he got chains on and he got all this stuff on and he got all this stuff and he's sagging and so forth like that. I'll never forget. See, sometimes we need to allow a person who is beginning their walk in the Spirit, because sometimes, watch this. It takes time for God to work out all the changes, just like he's doing with us. Yeah, it's all right. It's all right. It's all right. Just like he's doing with us. Now, watch this. I'm done. There he is, part of our youth group. I said, don't you mention anything about what he has on. He's saved, he's growing, he's in the Spirit, he wants life. No joke, one Sabbath. After church, you know, we always kicked it up, shouted it out. You know, I said, how you doing, man? What's your life like? Come on, talk to me. Are you positive? You know, it was a good week, it's a good week. He's still in Job Corps and all this kind of stuff. He said, you know, watch this. He looks at me, he said, Doc. He said, you know, I'm new. He said, man, since I've been here, man, I think differently. He goes, I'm going to live. I'm trying to figure out what God wants me to do. But he says, you be kind of dope dressing. He says, this is all I got. You know, he goes, you always tell me pull up my pants. But he goes, this is all I got. That's all I got. He goes, can I get one of those dope suits you got? True story. I said, you want a suit? He said, yeah, hey. He goes, man, I don't want to be like an oddball here. He goes, I don't rep. He says, I don't rep the gang anymore. He goes, I want to represent God now. Literally. His mind shifted. I said, sure. So I don't know what happened to me. I said, meet me. I said, meet me at this corner, you know, on Tuesday. I said, how's that fine? He said, no. Can you meet me at so-and-so on corner? I said, yeah. And I said, why you want to meet there? He goes, I'll tell you then. I got there on that Tuesday. He's handing me, watch this, an application because he's enrolling in the community college. My purpose shift. I said, you want to go? I said, what do you want to do? He told me. Filled it out for him. We get to the suit shop. And I don't know what came over me, Brenda. I don't know. I said, get you two suits. Always get a black one first. I said, then get a suit, whatever you want. And get you two shirts, and get you two ties, two pairs of shoes. I said, is this the devil talking through me? Because I ain't had no money. Come on and say amen. He said, you're going to give me two suits? I said, yeah. I said, go ahead. And in my mind, I said, now that one's maxed out. That one's maxed out. I'm going to test this one. And so he got something. Literally, he puts it on, tries it on, lays it on the counter. Dig into my wallet. Prayed over my card. It was taking a little time. I said, Lord, don't embarrass me in front of these kids. That Negro will leave the church. Come on. It went past. I said, hey! Hey, won't he do it? Won't he, won't he, won't he, won't And then, with tears in his eyes, he said, man, why are you doing this? I said, because God has done it for me, and he wants us to live. He wants to have abundant life. I said, man, whatever you need, man, I got you, I got you. But more than that, God has you, man. He's come that you might have life and have more abundantly. He says, man, I'm going to come to church on Saturday. He goes, I'm going to be clean like you. I said, man, you're going to be cleaner than me. And you're definitely going to have more money than me. Come on and say amen out there, because it was gone. It was gone. Okay. And then right before I dropped him off, he says, man, can I get another $25? I said, $25 for what? I said, now, he was kind of getting on my nerves, honest. I hear you. He said, man, you know, all these cornrows. He said, man, I want my stuff to, you know, kind of, no, nothing wrong with cornrows, but he wanted a total transformation. And that day, when the Sabbath came, he was usually at Sabbath school. He didn't show up. Usually the first ones at church were not there. I said, that boy got my suits and done gone. But 5 minutes before I started preaching, the back door is open. He comes to the back, hair, jewelry off, chains off, looking like $1 million, had his black suits on. And he told me later he wanted everybody in the church to know that he was a new man in Christ Jesus. All things are passed away. And he had a new attitude. Everybody standing. Father, we're so grateful for this moment. Thank you, Lord, for your spirit that convicts us to have a new mind shift. And as we recognize our identity in who we are, we can be and go from death to life. I thank you, Lord, for you allowing us just to teach today the truth about who we are. We declare your goodness, and there's somebody here who might need an effusion of life today. The enemy has convinced them that they are who and what they have done. Help them to understand, oh God, that we are who you say we are, heirs of the kingdom. So right now, there's somebody in this house who wants to come forward and receive the blessed promise of a new life in Christ Jesus right now. And if it's your desire to come and receive the power that only he gives, and you are committed now to begin to walk in the Spirit, walk in your sanctification, walk, if that is your desire, to receive your identity and to begin to renew and walk in the Spirit, you want to come right now as we end this service. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come Jesus just now, just now. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus. Everybody singing, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to just now, come to Jesus, come to Jesus, just now. He will save you. He will save you. and receive the power. Even if you want online to accept Jesus Christ, if you need prayer, this is your time to come and receive the transformation. Somebody here needs a new mindset, and if that's your desire, just come on. We just want to pray with you. God will come. He will save you. He will give you another chance. And if that's your desire, you will have freedom and victory, healing and wholeness at this time. And if you want to draw closer to God today, and if you want to say, God, this is my moment to renounce whatever the devil tries to do in my life. If you want to say, God, I want your power, I want your victory, I want your freedom, that only comes with walking in you. If that is your desire, just put your hand forward as we say our prayer. All right, right all over the building, I see the hands lifted up. Father, you see the hands. You know the power that we stand in need of. And so, Lord, as they lift up their hands, give them a touch. Help them to know that can't nobody do them like you can. So, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the change that will come because you have shifted their minds to help them to know that they belong to you. I thank you, Lord, for the freedom that comes from knowing that you are an awesome God. So take us, move in us, and then fill us with your power, then use us for your glory. Be with this congregation, and as we move forward in faith this week, help us to know that we can have the victory because you stand on our side. Thank you, and we praise you for every guest, every visitor. Free us into the end, in Jesus' name. If you love God, can you just put your hands together? Come on, we can do better than that. Come on, we can do better than that. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord.
Can we celebrate the man of God one more time today? Thank you so much, Doc, for allowing God to use you to bless us. Amen. If you look around, you realize that you see worship, you see connect, you see grow, you see serve, and you see give. These are the five core values of our church. And at this time, I want to draw your attention to the fifth one, which is give, because when the word of God goes forth, beyond responding to the appeal with a change of heart, there's also a calling on us for us to give, to progress the work of God, but also to acknowledge Him as the only source of all that we have. And so at this point, please pay attention to the screen. There are so many ways you can give. There's Venmo, there's Cash App, there's Zelle, you can use Realm, you can use the PO Box, but also if you want to give in person, there are receptacles at the back, and so on your way out, you can also give. Let's pray over the offerings today. Mighty God, we thank you so much that you did not give us a word only, but you also invite us to partner with you in growing the business of the church and making sure that there is always meat in your storehouse, and so that after your word has been preached, people can also be fed, but also people can also be taken care of. It's a privilege for us to take part in this. And so I'm asking that you bless all the offerings and you bless so that they will be administered well and bless all the people who would give today and those who are not able to give today too. I pray that you would bless them so that next time they will be able to give. Thank you for all that you're doing for our congregation, both online and in person. In the name of Jesus, I pray with thanksgiving. Amen and amen.
If you were blessed today and you were able to feel the Spirit of the Lord, can you put your hands together and praise God for meeting us where we are? We want to thank you for worshiping. Thank you for joining us here. We're going to have our benediction, so if you mind rising. And as you're standing, we want to let you know that we just don't want your experience here at Capitol Hill just to be on Saturday. We want you to join us Monday morning at 6:30 as you start off your day for our Joy in the Morning live on our YouTube and Facebook page. And on Wednesdays in the Word, we are going through our faith, the fundamentals of our faith series, and we want you to be a part of that as well. Let's pray. God, as we dismiss today and go downstairs to eat, God, we are asking that your spirit journey with us. Continue, God, to use us and help us to understand in our mind, God, that we are called by you for a purpose. And it is not just by willpower that we change, God, but by walking in your spirit. So let us not leave, God, just convicted, but let us leave transformed to live a life of purpose, God, and to live a life that will continue, God, to display your honor and your glory no matter where we go. This is my prayer. In your name I pray. And the church said, amen, amen. You are dismissed.